25 years ago, the beautiful and the damned of the 1920s knew ridicule was nothing to be scared of. A world of glitter and glamour became, for a fleeting moment, the centre of the universe.
They look like beautiful, hollow creatures, and that was the image they tried to cultivate at the time.
Stephen has gold dust in his hair. He has Vaseline on his eyelids. And he has lipstick.
Banded together in the pursuit of a good time, a killer wardrobe and very little else, the bright young people ripped through British society and became notorious.
There was a kind of perverse wish to behave as irresponsibly and as childishly as they could.
A lot of drink. In some cases, a lot of drugs and some very, very glamorous locations.
They're creating this kind of fantasy, which is a rejection of the values of their parents, but also the values of their time as well.
The bright young things had a shimmering allure, and inevitably, the literati followed the glitterati. A generation of artists drew inspiration from this flowering of doomed youth, and they used it to found their reputations.
People like Cecil Beaton were the sort of Malcolm McLaren of their day. You know, they were popularising it. They were making their careers out of this.
Glamour and celebrity became an industry. The cult of personality and the incestuous relationship between the bright young people and the press is instantly recognisable today.
I think the rest of the nation were enormously entertained by it because it was like the celebrity culture now.
But who were the real bright young people? Why were they such a phenomenon? And how did something so short-lived come to be so immortalised? The interwar era is an age that we can't help but return to again and again. So familiar are its nuances, its sense of modernity, that it appears to exert a hold and a lasting influence over the collective imagination. The same can be said of its great social set, the bright young things, party pioneers of the 20th century.
I'd have loved to have seen one of the bright young people in their heyday. I mean, they had the most fantastic clothes, the most fantastic sort of conception of themselves, the most flamboyant way of projecting themselves, and it really was about identity as much as it was just about sort of vanity.
Defiantly partying while ignoring life's harsher realities, their bittersweet world of decadent glamour and outrageous attention-seeking holds a mirror to many of our present-day obsessions and fears.
There was a feeling of hopelessness, and part of the partying was just to push that away. Let's go out, let's get drunk, let's not think about it.
What we recognise in them is the pose of superior entitlement, the glossy perfection and idealised lifestyle that contemporary luxury brands still sell us today. What is different, though, is that the bright young people of the 20s were not aping the behaviour of a previous generation. They were the originals, and the bright young people are still the very definition of decadent glamour. At the very heart of this scene were a select few real bright young people, absolute stars in their day, but whose names have since been almost forgotten. Aristocratic aesthetes like the flamboyant Stephen Tennant were central to the new social set's rejection of conformity.
When Stephen left his house, there was a reporter there to see him coming out in his football jersey and a pair of earrings, and driving across London in this electric brougham, which was described as a shop window on wheels. And he's kind of waving to the people as he goes past. He is this celebrity.
His slender, androgynous frame, Marcel-waved hair, and wardrobe of embroidered silks made him a rebel, but also the toast of London.
The comparisons with people like Boy George or, you know, any kind of sort of very outrageous pop star are very acute. I mean, that was what Stephen was. In an age before pop stars, Stephen was a pop star.
Newly freed from their Edwardian skirts and overbearing governesses, well-bred, modern girls became party-obsessed. none more so than Elizabeth Ponsonby. This flighty daughter of an MP had a dedication to partying that marked her as the 1920s it girl, but would ultimately destroy her.
I think for us it's interesting because of how she died. You know, she drank herself to death and she died before she was 40. But in the 1920s, she was famous just for being a silly, frivolous girl who went to parties.
The hardcore hedonism and possibility of fame drew in high-born hipsters like actress Brenda Dean Paul, who was there from the scene's very inception.
There were bright young women, certainly, who were able to sustain this existence, more or less on air. I mean, Brenda Dean Paul, who achieved fame as what was known as the society drug addict, as the papers knew her, in the early 1930s, maintained that she spent several years just living on brandy cocktails and salted nuts.
This outrageous self-publicist learned that causing a sensation, no matter how tragic, could be made to pay. On the fringes of the set, drawn to these wild, glamorous luminaries, were artists, writers, and entertaining types with a variety of backgrounds. Some out for what they could get, others revelling in the excess, but all of them observing and recording. It is their creativity and interpretation of the scene that sustained it and made it both legend and fable. Among them, Cecil Beaton, John Betjeman, Nancy Mitford, Noel Coward and Evelyn Waugh have become synonymous with the decade that roared and the beautiful but damned young people who partied to the end.
In a sense, Evelyn Waugh stood for that generation of bright young people in that he was a rebel and he loved the rebellion of it, the throwing over the rules. He also loved getting really, really drunk. At the same time, he knew perfectly well in his heart of hearts that he was not one of the bright young people. He loved fooling around with them. He was enormously entertained with them. He loved their glamour, and he wanted to be part of them up to a point, but he knew he was different.
Waugh had got to know many of the bright young men at Oxford. They belonged to a rather exclusive, Eton-educated, entitled class above Waugh's own middle-class background. But his wit and rebellious nature were all he needed to join the bright young society.
All doors were open suddenly, among the young anyway. And if they were amusing, if they were entertaining, then they were acceptable, that they were accepted. That was the criterion, that was the sole criterion, really.
When the aspiring young writer took to London's bright young scene, he found within it the characters and backdrops for his first two novels, Decline and Fall and Vile Bodies. In each book, the bright young thing's extravagant partying, dress sense and even their affected and arch lexicon is perfectly documented.
I think Stephen Fry's film, Bright Young Things, which is based on Evelyn Waugh's book, Vile Bodies, is actually really successful in portraying the sheer madness and mayhem of those events. And the opening sequence of the film, where you have this fantastic sort of Dante's Inferno party with, you know, everyone dressed as sort of demons and sometimes angels. It's fantastic, and it's set in obviously a sort of a Park Lane apartment, which existed before they all pulled down, indeed before the Second World War. And, you know, you go through these red curtains, you know, into this amazing sort of dance floor. And you do have people like Miles Malpractice, who is a character in Waugh's book, who is based partly on Stephen Tennant. David Lennox, who's based on Cecil Beaton. Miles Malpractice is snorting cocaine and kissing men with wolves' heads and all sorts of strange things like this. One of the funniest things about that opening sequence is where you have Nina and Miles just dancing madly, you know, sort of in the Charleston and sort of on a cocaine high, and there's just madness going on around them, sort of mayhem.
Nina!
Miles!
Adam, not back yet.
What?
Adam, not back yet.
Any day now.
Isn't this too dull?
I've never been more bored in my life.
There was a definite way of talking, almost a kind of argo, which the bright young people developed. All the kind of slang that Waugh puts into Vile Bodies, or, you know, my dear, how too drunk making, how what a bogus man, bogus meaning insincere, fake.
Come too dreary. They're like flies, aren't they?
I think they're after Agatha.
You know, her father made the most crashing speech about customs officers in the House of Lords this evening. Several bishops burst into tears, apparently.
That dreadful Simon Bull Cairn, I swear he tips them off. Where are we going?
3:30. Lottie will be closing now. How about the Ritz?
Oh, talk sense, dearest. Not while I'm dressed like this.
The way they peppered their conversation with extraordinary kind of mixture of jazz slang with camp mannerisms, calling everyone darling or things divine, you know, just over-emphasising everything.
The characteristic bright young person's mode of speech, very high-pitched and sort of drawling, was developed simply so that it could be communicated across above the noise of gramophone records, you see, so you could talk while you were dancing to the noise of a wind-up gramophone.
This was a younger generation craving and creating a culture of its own. Anything that represented the Stoic patriotism and tradition of their parents was out. Everything exotic and modern was in. And that included their taste in music. So the wild, primitive sound of jazz was a bright young thing obsession. These young people were clearly on a mission to enjoy themselves, and to hell with everything else.
This was the generation that had missed the war, so on the one hand, they felt guilty almost for having not been there, and secondly, they were sick to death of the war, and nothing but talk of the war. And they didn't want anything to do with it. So I think that's a large part of what was fueling what, to the older generation, seemed outrageous behaviour.
There was a kind of perverse wish, I think, on the part of a lot of people to behave as irresponsibly and as childishly as they could. Largely as a way of cocking a snook, I think, at the people who expected so much of them. I think there was a lot of that. There was a lot of sort of deliberate copying out from the sort of the approved rules and regulations and career paths that one's parents perhaps wanted one to pursue.
They are like the first teenagers in a way. You know, this is the first time, you know, everything was expendable in a way. Life was expendable. That's what the First World War taught them, was actually, you know, carpe diem, live for the day. That was the whole thing. Just live for now.
The roots of the scene can be traced to the early 20s and the activities of a few bored society women who began using central London as a playground for their increasingly elaborate scavenger or treasure hunts.
One of the girls who was very involved in these treasure hunts was later asked how they started, and she said, oh, well, on blank afternoons we used to chase each other around London, and we used to get onto, you know, one girl would have a head start of 5 minutes and then the others would chase her on the tube and on the buses. And you can imagine this group of kind of well-heeled, well-dressed young girls shrieking as they went on these new forms of public transportation, which they wouldn't have travelled on in a normal situation. You know, they would only have gone anywhere by taxi or in a private motor car. And this idea of kind of mingling with the common people for fun was utterly new.
With huge imagination and time on their hands to use it, these treasure hunts grew in scale until swelled ranks of the well-to-do young took to their motor cars and chased after ever more extravagant artifacts by elaborately constructed clues.
Because they were all born into the purple and very well connected, these lists of items might include the Prime Minister's pipe or a pair of stays worn by a West End actress.
And some of these clues were extraordinary, but Lord Beaverbrook agreed to publish clues in his own newspapers for them. They ended up in these madcap, drunken charges through sort of narrow streets in Soho and Chelsea, these cars, you know, being driven by these drunken fools, a lot of women as well, you know, and of course, you know, women being drunk in public at that point was completely outrageous.
Although automobile production all but halted during the Great War, developments in mass production techniques meant that the post-war era saw the motor car become ever more popular and faster.
Bright Young Things wouldn't have existed without the motor car. That's what gets them around. I mean, they're driving around drunk part of the time. You know, Waugh is always being prosecuted for driving the wrong way round a roundabout. These are toys to them. You know, London is a big adventure playground to them. You know, they're just let loose on this place.
This was a phenomenon in search of a name. At the end of July 1924, the press gave it one.
Readers of the Daily Mail woke up to this inflammatory report which said that there was, the headline went, Chasing Clues, New Society Game. And then there was this banner headline that said, Midnight Chase in London, 50 Motor Cars, The Bright Young People.
The 1920s saw a kind of mania for brightness. In the aftermath of the darkness of World War I, the word bright signalled the right sort of optimistic exuberance.
There were an awful lot of press campaigns, sometimes for quite trivial things like brighter golf, and there was a whole campaign for a brighter London at one point in the 1920s. And so the adjective bright was very much in the public consciousness at that time. And so a young person who did something extraordinary or in any way outlandish wouldn't have been surprised, I think, to have been called a bright young person in the context of the time.
With a handy label attached, stories about this new generation's exciting but more and more outrageous behaviour both titillated and shocked the public.
The rise of the bright young people coincided with a mini-revolution in the world of newspapers, which they were A, exploited by, and B, able to exploit.
Daily popular newspapers like the Daily Mail, the Express and the Sketch had been launched before the Great War, but it wasn't until the 20s that they really started to take off. Aimed at the burgeoning middle class and upper lower class readers, their agenda and presentation shifted quite intentionally away from the austere and rather serious Victorian press.
These new popular papers were very different in content. They prized human interest above all. It was about personalities, celebrities, gossip, scandal if it was there. It was also about features about personal life, domestic life, the private as well as the high political and the public.
There was a conscious effort on the part of newspaper proprietors like Lord Northcliffe of the Mail and Beaverbrook to go for what young people were up to, you know, flamboyant young people and their antics. They thought that their readers would respond to this.
And the search for a cast of personalities that could populate the columns day in, day out, really led to the modern day gossip column. And these bright young people were there to be photographed, there to be talked about day in, day out.
Gossip wasn't entirely new to the newspapers and periodicals of the 20s, but the people who were employed to gather it and to write it certainly were.
The gossip writer of the pre-war period would probably have been a woman with a certain amount of journalistic experience who would have worked for a society lady. And when that society lady was ill, you know, she would have sent a note of this expressing general regret to the newspaper. And when she was better, another note expressing general satisfaction would go to the newspaper. If she attended the Eton Harrow cricket match, a photograph of her would be sent to the But you see, the people doing the insinuating were not the social equals of the people who were being written about. Come the mid-1920s, when the newspapers woke up to the fact that you know, there were readers to be gained from this kind of society gossip, they began to employ people who would actually have gone to the parties themselves.
A bit of extra cash in exchange for insider tips and gossip would have been of little interest to the aristocracy before the Great War. But tax changes in the 20s meant many were in no position to turn it down.
One of the things that changes after the First World War is that the position of the aristocracy is changing. It's declining, really. The value of agricultural land has declined. The burden of taxation has risen. The impact of the First World War in terms of deaths, the changing political climate, all of this puts pressure on the aristocracy. Many of them are no longer as rich as they were before.
By the end of the 1920s, you see what was a very unusual phenomenon in the context of the time, which is very well-educated and well-born young people becoming society columnists.
These people were living beyond their means. They wanted to attend all these parties and they couldn't afford their lifestyles unless they were subsidised by the papers.
Patrick Balfour, who was Mr. Gossip on the Daily Sketch, he's Evelyn Waugh's Mr. Chatterbox in Vile Bodies, or Dryburgh, who was the dragoman on the Express. people such as that occupied positions of great power in terms of gossip columns. And many a bright young person affiliated to people like Balfour and Dryburgh made pin money by attending a grand party or a not so grand bohemian party, and at about midnight finding a telephone and phoning in details of it to whichever newspaper they had an entree into.
The press and the well-connected bright young people developed a cosy collusion in the 20s that delivered rewards on both sides.
It hadn't been done quite like that before. There had been gossip and there had been scandal, but the people who had reported had never actually been mixing with the people whose antics they were commenting on.
By the mid-1920s, the bright young people's scavenger hunts had given way to stunt parties. These events were elaborately themed fancy dress affairs that spun out of control and went on all night.
The dressing up parties speak for themselves. You've got cowboy parties and circus parties and come as you were 20 years ago parties.
You dress up as a famous character from history, and there's a lot of obviously a cross-dressing there.
Men dressed as women dressed as men.
Lesbians dressed as admirals and that kind of thing.
Men wore jewellery, they wore makeup.
There would be Greek parties, there was an urban Dionysia.
I certainly know one party that Lord Bath told me about, they danced across the counters of Selfridges. You have to see this in the context of what had gone before, you know, these dreary Victorian receptions and even the Edwardian era, which was rather sort of gayer in the language of the time.
Before the Great War, the round of debutante balls and official dinners that young aristocrats would be subjected to as part of the season were very strictly controlled occasions, constructed with the barely veiled aim of marrying off the participants as neatly as possible to their class counterparts. The First World War changed that completely.
For the bright young things, it's kind of complete reinvention of the way one might hold a party. The notion of the bring a bottle party was invented by the bright young things. And it was partly because many of them were actually hard up. Or the other key thing really is very interesting to note is that a lot of it came from Oxford and Cambridge, where they weren't allowed to go to pubs. So they have bring a bottle party. So this was a sort of university thing.
With each week, a new party theme emerged.
David Tennant, who was Stephen Tennant's brother, had a very famous party where everyone dressed up as characters from Mozart. And there are extraordinary photographs of them all in sort of like 18th century wigs and breeches in the middle of the street with a workman's steam hammer.
The bright young people became increasingly aware there was an audience for their provocative behaviour. The party elite understood the power of their stunt photo opportunities and appearances in the gossip columns. Their fame, or infamy, was growing.
Because they knew the press, because they had reporters at the beck and call, at their beck and call, because some bright young people were reporters themselves, quite small parties containing only a few people in quite out-of-the-way places could be reported in newspapers as if the whole of fashionable London had either gone to them or wanted to be there.
This incestuous relationship with the popular press allowed the bright young set to control their own mystique and legend.
People in Bradford and Solihull did know who Stephen Tennant was. They knew what the bright young things were. They might have taken the mickey out of them, but they also gave them a laugh in a way. And actually, I think, you know, people like Stephen would have been quite amused by that as well.
Hedonism and glamour ruled like never before, and the bright young people's happenings became increasingly provocative.
One party, which to us seems almost sick in a way, 1927, was everyone had to come dressed as a beggar. I mean, this is a year after the general strike. I mean, how offensive is that, really? But of course, there are all these descriptions of Stephen Tennant dressed in wonderful rags, showing a little bit of leg and things. It's kind of, oh, you know. Then it started getting utterly ridiculous. People came dressed as babies, you know, drinking alcohol out of babies' bottles.
It There was a famous party given by a woman called Rosemary Sanders where they turned up in kind of baby carriages.
One girl came driven in a pram by her mother, wearing a full kind of Victorian children's outfit, and the mother was dressed in her Victorian clothes.
Commentators at the time, in the mid-1920s, were very quick to comment on the childishness of it all, the infantilism almost of it all.
They really wanted to stay in the nursery, I think, and therefore what everything was geared towards was having very childish nursery behaviour continuing, but in a grown-up way. In other words, with a lot of drink, in some cases a lot of drugs, and some very, very glamorous locations.
Though the elder generation were publicly disapproving, privately they were prepared to indulge the new generation's naughtiness, and like so many others, they were intrigued by its excesses.
What I always wonder, Katia, is what they actually do at these parties of theirs. I mean, do they? My dear, from all I hear, I think they do. Oh, to be young again, Kitty. Well, I think, my dear, of all the trouble and exertion we had to go through to be even moderately bad.
And indeed, the bright young people were up to all sorts.
Every exploit had to be more outrageous than the next, you know, and many of them involved sort of expeditions down to Limehouse to get a sort of score their cocaine.
And there were sort of harder drugs around to which several of the bright young people ultimately became hooked. Hashish, which was then known as Indian hemp, was certainly smoked at some of these gatherings, and licentious behaviour there certainly was.
I mean, a lot of these people were either, you know, addicted to cocaine, to heroin. They're drinking all the time. When you read Evelyn Waugh's accounts of life in Oxford, I mean, he's just drunk all the time, all the time.
I found Richard and brought him in, and we drank large quantities of a dangerous mixture by William, which consisted chiefly of champagne, gin and absinthe. We were by now raging drunk, and I can remember very little about the party, except that I fought someone.
Not everyone was attracted to the scene purely because of these excesses. In 1926, an aspiring photographer with one eye on advancing his career was desperate to muscle in on some of the bright young thing action.
So this is Sotheby's collection of Cecil Beaton's prints, in fact, his whole collection. Extraordinary. These are the actual filing cabinets which Beaton gave the collection to Sotheby's in, sold it, and they are some unbelievable photographs of the young and very exquisite photographer at the very beginning of his career. I mean, this is a man, really, who created the bright young things, who created the image of them. And really, it's through Beaton's lens that their beauty was memorialised. But you can see Beaton himself was the most extraordinary-looking character. He was a very ordinary middle-class boy, really, but he created himself into this exquisite figure.
Like Waugh, spare time and a limitless supply of money were not available to the young Cecil Beaton. If he was to party in the higher echelons of society, he would have to make it pay.
If we talk about the bright young people as occupying a sort of social mixture of classes, so that you've got the younger sons of aristocrats, you've got younger daughters, you know, daughters of aristocrats who want to do something fun before they get married or have a career themselves. You've also got these kind of middle class boys in particular who are hoping to make their career out of being a part of this group.
He was by no means a conventional bright young person. His father was a timber merchant. He'd been to Harrow and Cambridge, which may not sound like disadvantages, but they were compared to the sons of noblemen who'd been to Eton and Oxford. He felt that he was being discriminated against socially, that he was looked down upon and belittled because of his origins.
Although on the surface he became every inch the bright young person, behind the glamorous facade, his decidedly middle-class entrepreneurial instinct and ambition were working overtime.
His diaries are almost naked in their cynicism, in their interest in what he calls the uprise, meaning his own uprise and his career path. One can see the extraordinary lengths he was prepared to go to insert himself into high society.
Brilliantly, Cecil Beaton used to send photographs he'd taken of his sisters to Tatler magazine, pretending they were sent in by somebody else in order to promote his own name at Tatler. And that's how he got his first job. And he went from Tatler to Vogue to Vanity Fair. You know, mission accomplished.
Beaton presented nothing as tiresome as reality, but instead an idealised fantasy. This concoction was irresistible to both the image-obsessed bright young person and to those vicariously enjoying the lifestyle through the magazines who published his work.
His lens was very flattering. He was a great one with the airbrush, or the airbrush of his day. He was a great retoucher. This is a man who had the eye, but he was also part of the action. He was part of that society. Really, Beaton helped define the bright young things.
These people were really geniuses in terms of image and creating image and scene setting. In the same way as when we look at Gainsborough portraits, we can get an idea of what the 18th century aristocracy wanted to, how they wanted to project themselves. We get exactly the same thing through Cecil Beaton's photographs in the 1920s.
The immediacy of photography meant that more than ever, the notion of image and literally the way one was seen became something to be played with and exploited.
The way they look at the camera, there's an incredibly knowing glance there. There's a complicity. There's a contract, really, with the man who's photographing them, with the people who are going to look at them. You want to see me. You know, I am some example of, you know, your dreams. I live beyond your ordinary, boring life, you know. I don't exist in your world, but here's a little bit of me that I'm sharing with you, you know. And it's really that, and it's a piece of alchemy in a way, but it is also a devil's contract, because we know the price of that for them is also very often oblivion.
Poster boys and girls for little more than an attitude, the bright young things found themselves being used as both clarion call and warning sign for modern appetites. They encapsulated an aspirational, glamorous and dangerous existence.
It's the first time the notion of a lifestyle is evolved in a way. So the power of that, the commercial power of that, apart from anything else, is very important. And the bright young things, in a way, you know, they're almost there to sell clothes and perfume or whatever. They might not be advertising them, although many of them did. But that becomes, you know, the start of that new kind of society. And that's really an important part of what they represented.
Despite the commercial appropriation of the bright young brand, the everyday activity of the party set continued, with a wit and knowing kind of irony that emphasised its exclusivity. Events like the impersonation party of 1927 were seized upon as opportunities to revel in their own notoriety.
You were invited to come to a house in Mayfair dressed as somebody else. And it was a mark of the bright young people's reflexiveness, I suppose, and the rather incestuous quality of the movement, that several bright young people came as other bright young people. They were that celebrated even then. Tom Dryberg, the society columnist, he was the dragoman, as he was known, on the Daily Express, arranged his hair so that he looked like Brian Howard. And, but other people, you know, came in sort of more respectable guises. Stephen Tennant famously appeared as Queen Maria of Romania, possibly looking more sort of feminine and regal than the lady did herself. The actress Tallulah Bankhead came as Jean Barotra, the tennis player. That made an extraordinary stir, the impersonation party.
Look at this. Noel Coward, Marlene Dietrich, John Gielgud. They're all here. But I'm looking for someone particular. Ah, gosh. Stephen Tennant. Whole file. God, this is so exciting.
When the sun set on the bright young heyday in the 1930s, Stephen Tennant retreated from the world and lived the life of an eccentric recluse in his Wiltshire home. Although he outlived most of his bright young contemporaries, when he died in 1988, his place in the bright young era had been all but forgotten.
These are archive prints from Wilsford, the house Stephen lived in, where I actually visited him in 1986. I mean, this is a man who really defined the 1920s, as far as I'm concerned.
Born in 1906, Stephen Tennant was the youngest son of the Earl of Glenconner. He was a precocious, artistic child, indulged by his mother and babied by his nanny.
This is what he grew up to be. Probably the most androgynous, the most extraordinary man of his generation. I mean, I say man, I know the sculptor Jacob Epstein said that Stephen was the most beautiful creature, male or female, he'd ever seen in his life.
Independently wealthy, with an eternally childlike passion for any beauty and pleasure, Stephen was the absolute bright young man. Not in the least concerned about the fuss his clothing and makeup caused, Stephen Tennant, in a very modern way, was his own work of art. And if that attracted attention, so be it.
Stephen has gold dust in his hair. He has Vaseline on his eyelids. And he has lipstick. But the effect is not effeminate. It's just an otherworldly image. I mean, it could be from Andy Warhol's factory in the 1960s. It's so modern, I think. And I know Caroline Blackwood, who was Lucian Freud's wife, said Stephen was the nearest thing to David Bowie they had in those days, really. And there is a sort of degree of that sort of glam rock allure about him, the sheen. Indeed, the whole of his bedroom was papered in silver foil. I mean, it really is like sort of some 60s acid casualty in a way. But the thing about Stephen was he was this extraordinary artificial creation. And that's what is most exciting about this box, is that it kind of contains all that we have of Stephen now. That's all that's left of him is in this box. Rebel, rebel, how could they know?
Hot tramp, I love you so. Although he was a proficient sketcher, painter and enthusiastic writer, other than the photographs that Cecil Beaton took of him, Stephen Tennant would leave no tangible personal legacy. His art was an ephemeral performance that, to his creative friends like Beaton and the young Nancy Mitford, offered the most magnificent inspiration.
Nancy modelled Cedric in The Pursuit of Love and Love in a Cold Climate very much on Stephen Tennant. His beauty and his extraordinary affectations, and the coat, the dark blue coat with the red piping that so enrages her father in the novel, Lord Reedsdale, in fact, I think was all taken from life and was all from one of... was all comes from Stephen Tennant. He was the kind of ne plus ultra of the outrageous, beautiful, gay young man. And Nancy couldn't get enough of it.
A glitter of blue and gold crossed the parquet and a human dragonfly was kneeling on the fur rug in front of the mondor. One long white hand extended towards each. He was a tall, thin young man, supple as a girl, dressed in rather a bright blue suit. His hair was the gold of a brass bedknob, and his insect appearance came from the fact that the upper part of the face was concealed by blue goggles, set in gold rims, quite an inch thick.
A man to look the way Stephen did in 1927 was a kind of gesture against everything, really, that had gone before. It was a gesture against patriarchal society, it was a gesture against all the kind of values that had caused the First World War. For someone to actually look like that now was really just sort of two fingers against the world.
In an era of very strict dress codes, the bright young things pushed the sartorial boundaries to breaking point. For a decade, it was hemlines at dawn. Shiny, transparent, short, androgynous and louche. If it broke the rules, they wore it.
a bright young person did their best, I think, to shock their parents, which, when it came to the girls, meant short skirts, a lot of makeup, shingled hair, all the things that your parents would have raised their eyes to the ceiling in horror.
At the heart of the bright young party set, costume became a competitive obsession. Presented with only the most blasé of attitudes, attention to detail, wit, and of course excess were what was most prized in an outfit.
So preparations for an evening out for someone like Stephen Tennant would be, you'd be backing, talking sort of a week of preparations for a particular evening out, you know. So the costume fittings, you know, this was like a sort of an 18th century, you know, courtesan in a way. So there would be costume fittings, you know. Then there'd be a series of phone calls between friends agreeing what you were going to wear. And the great thing that Stephen always used to take the Michael out of Cecil Beaton was because Cecil Beaton would say, oh, I'm not really going to dress up, you know, I'm just going to rummage around. And then, of course, you'd arrive as sort of Marie Antoinette or whatever, you know, full wig and gown and everything. You know, he'd spent weeks getting this costume together.
It was fun for the bright young aristocrats and hangers-on to race around partying in the capital, but the need for new and ever more extravagant ways to fill their spare time saw them hit the road for more exclusive adventures.
This notion that you sort of decamp to someone's stately pile for a weekend was key in a way, and of course the fact that they all had motor cars to drive there was another part of the fun. For Cecil Beaton, it was being invited to Stephen Tennant's house, Wilsford Manor, just outside Salisbury, was really one of the moments at which he really felt himself being taken into the society. For Cecil to arrive in his leopard skin pyjamas and, you know, lay them out on the bed and sort of just amazed at being this sort of 12-bedroom house, and the fact that you'd have a footman laying out your underwear, you know, he'd had to go and buy new sets of underwear from Selfridges the day before. And, you know, he puts on his dressing gown and just feels he's completely part of it. And it is one big choreographed performance, you know. I kind of feel sorry for the guests at Wilsford in a way, because they were all dragooned by Stephen into, like, fancy dress for the whole weekend, you know. And probably the most famous image, really, in a way, of the bright young things is this image from Wilsford Manor, taken by Cecil Beaton, of Stephen's Fête Champêtre, which is this kind of recreation of a 18th century watercolour on a bridge over the River Avon at the end of the garden. And, you know, you have these people, you have Rex Whistler, Cecil Beaton himself, Georgia Sitwell, William Walton, the famous composer, here wearing full makeup, Stephen Tennant, of course, and the Youngman sisters. This is theatre. And it's theatre for, in this respect, it's theatre for a private audience here. This is the real heart of bright young thing society, in a way, where there is actually not even an audience. They're doing it for themselves.
They all look like immensely sort of stylized Morris dancers, but worse than that, there's a sort of harlequinade. And in fact, the whole scene was observed by Lytton Strachey, who happened to be calling at the time and walked up the Wilsford Drive and saw this extraordinary tableau enacted in front of him and just was incredulous and said something like, you know, extraordinary people with a few feathers where brains should be. Which, of course, is an oversimplification, because some of the bright young people were immensely astute and immensely clever, but they invited you not to take them seriously, and a lot of people consequently didn't take them seriously.
But, of course, Lytton Strachey brings Siegfried Sassoon, the great war poet, who falls in love with Stephen. It's the great bright young thing romance, doomed to failure, of course, but it's, you know, of course, the great sort of gossip of the day.
In the 1920s, even though homosexuality was illegal and punished severely, within the confines of the bright young society, gay and lesbian affairs were accepted. Using fancy dress as an excuse to wear makeup and cross-dress, Stephen Tennant was by no means alone in his obvious homosexuality. The bright young set was awash with similar gay young dandies.
That notion of homosexuality as being accepted is really key to that period in a way. It's what binds a lot of these people together. You know, there's a lot of lesbianism as well, because, of course, the first sort of lesbian book, The Well of Loneliness by Radcliffe Hall, is published around this time. This is the first time these conditions, as well people regard them, had been given names. No longer are their sexualities or their otherness means of weakness or of attack. They're means of strength. You know, the gay figures in Brideshead Revisited, people like Anthony Blanche, who's based on Howard Acton, a mixture of Howard Acton and Brian Howard, these are people who were not, they were not effete, really, in a way. They were kind of out about it and very pugnacious about it, you know.
About six of them came into my room. The rest stood mouthing outside. My dear, they looked too extraordinary. They'd been having one of their ridiculous club dinners, and they were all wearing coloured tailcoats, a sort of livery. My dears, I said to them, you look like a lot of most disorderly footmen. Then one of them, rather a juicy little piece, accused me of unnatural vices. My dear, I said, I may be inverted, but I am not insatiable. Come back when you are alone.
They were modern figures, you know, and this is the way they saw the world going. You know, this was a way of modern life.
Within the bright young coterie, aristocratic women were also freed from the era's most genteel expectations, and for better or worse, smoked, drank, and took centre stage. Evelyn Waugh was so impressed and fascinated by one of these wild, irresponsible modern women that he immortalised her as a central character in his satirical novel Vile Bodies.
One of the scenes in Bright Young Things, which is an adaptation of Vile Bodies, has Agatha Runcible, the anti-heroine, I think we could call her, who's based on someone called Elizabeth Ponsonby, and she is caught by and searched by the customs officers at Dover as the ship lands at the start of the film.
Oh! Adam, darling!
Hello, Agatha.
I never saw you on a boat. I can't tell you the things that have been happening to me in there. The way they looked. Too shaming. Positively surgical, my dear, and such wicked old women. I shall ring up every cabinet minister and all the newspapers and give them the most shy-making details. Let's find the train.
Oh, I've got troubles of my own.
She utterly ignores her friend's predicament. I mean, he's actually in real trouble. He's had a book on which his future depends confiscated. She doesn't even listen to him. All she's interested in is the party that they're going to go to in London that night. So she's utterly unaffected by how ridiculous she looks.
Archie's work's giving a lovely party tonight, so we simply have to catch the next train, or I shall not have a chance to dress.
Archie, who?
Elizabeth Ponsonby, like her fictional rendering Agatha Runcible, was a magnet for the press. Her passion for partying, coupled with having an aristocratic politician for a father, made her a prime target for photo opportunities and gossip stories. But the truth was that Elizabeth Ponsonby couldn't really afford the extravagant life she chose to lead. Her father's home, Shoolbreed Priory in Surrey, was the destination for the odd bright young weekend and is still the Ponsonby family residence.
We're extraordinarily lucky because our family have preserved almost everything, diaries, letters, photographs, all stage pictures and playbills that marked Elizabeth's early fascination with theatre. Her family belonged to what is, well, really rather an obscure quadrant of English social life these days. I could only describe them as the aristocratic poor.
By using every penny of her allowance, the copper she could make from pawning her possessions and amassing enormous debts, Elizabeth achieved legendary status as the 20s it girl, without whom a party just wasn't a party.
And here is the poem that John Betjeman wrote for his friend Patrick Balfour on his 70th birthday, where he reminisces about that whole late 1920s scene. And it goes, I hear the clink of glasses in my memory's ear, the spurt of soda as the whiskey rose, bringing its heady scent to memory's nose, along with smells one otherwise forgets, hair wash from Delette's, Turkish cigarettes, the reek of Ronak on a parquet floor, as parties came cascading through the door, Elizabeth Ponsonby in leopard skins.
Without any particular intellectual ability or talent, there wasn't a great deal a young woman like Elizabeth Ponsonby could do in the 1920s. So she made the best of what she knew she was good at. And that was throwing parties and drawing attention to herself wherever she went.
This was an age in which everybody colluded with the media, and the bright young person really was judged by the weight of their press cuttings and photographs. And what we have here is an album that Elizabeth kept herself. It's an elaborate chronicle of the kind of life that she lived in the late 1920s, the people she lived it with, the celebrities that she came across. And in each photograph, this pale and sometimes not terribly happy-looking young woman stares forth. You can see in the bright young people and their relationships with the media, you can see the beginnings of modern celebrity culture. You can see the beginnings of people being famous for being famous. Someone like Elizabeth Ponsonby, for example, did nothing except turn up in society columns, and she would be involved in one outrageous stunt after another. And people would be able to track her career through the press by means of this.
Where Elizabeth Ponsonby was a hapless but gifted amateur in the game of self-publicity, other bright young people took to it like professionals.
The most famous one of all, whose celebrity was such that it eventually went all the way down into the tabloid newspapers, like the News of the World and the Star and papers like that, was Brenda Dean Paul, known as the society drug addict, who spent years in and out of prison, in and out of rehab, and whose career was monitored by the press in much the same way that, Katie Price and Peter Andre are now. And whatever she did, there would be a newspaper headline to match.
Always more Hollywood wild child than Mayfair Deb, the baronet's daughter turned wannabe actress had swung it in the nightclubs of Weimar Berlin and lounged in the flesh pots of permissive Paris, where she infamously first got acquainted with heroin.
People like Brenda Dean Paul were great sort of users of the media of their time, and she would sort of write journalism when she needed money, basically for drugs.
She threw her suitcases down the stairs once at some reporters who were harassing her. But then a fortnight later she'd be hard up and forced to write a series of articles about her holiday in Tahiti, and the whole thing would go on again.
She had the story of her life ghosted, My First Life, which was published, and she came back sort of almost to promote it. She had this sort of amazing drug collapse at the airport when she was coming back from Paris, and she sort of picked up off the floor, and, you know, it's a publicity stunt in a way, you know.
Rather like, you know, modern celebrities today who complain about being harassed and badgered by the press, but at the same time are setting up incidents in which they know the press will be able to help them to their advantage.
This Faustian pact struck with the press in the 1920s clearly could not last. As the new decade dawned, onlookers found less to be entertained by and more to criticise about the antics of the bright young people. Even within the scene itself, the anticipation of a massive collective hangover was beginning to take hold.
I think certainly there was a feeling that this was the party at the end of the world and everything was going to change, and it was going to change, not in a nice way.
The champagne corks were always sort of bobbing away on a stream that was leading somewhere not terribly pleasant.
In the autumn of 1931, the ill-timed red and white ball was the lavish, bright young party that for the press and public was a party too far.
You came dressed in red or white, you ate things like strawberries or red-coloured cocktails, you smoked white cigarettes, you ate white chicken, and it went all night. I think Brenda Dean Paul was arrested for trying to pull some woman's hair out. I think there may have been a drugs bust. And this was the party, the symbolic party, after which even the society magazines turned on the bright young people, because the reports of this coincided with a march of unemployed workers from the north down to London.
The party decade of consumption and boom was being symbolically paid for by industrial unrest and fiscal uncertainty. Across Europe, economies and governments were collapsing, with the extremes of fascism and communism taking hold. The thought of a rarefied few kicking up their heels and ignoring the sober realities of the day had grown increasingly repulsive.
Even the bystanders said that you cannot go on behaving like this when starving men are coming south, you know, from the distressed areas to petition their MPs. And that was more or less, you know, the winding up of the pleasure-seeking last 6 or 7 years.
The main players are no longer major players. They're bored of what they were once doing. And also society as a whole is bored of what the bright young people had got up to. They're much more interested in the international politics at the time, with the spectre of German power reviving. They're more interested in rebuilding the British economy. It's a different sort of world in the 1930s, and the bright young people just don't fit into it anymore.
The bright young chroniclers were the first to spot the decaying of the movement, and ultimately they were the survivors. Waugh's novel Vile Bodies, written in 1929, had predicted dire consequences for the pursuit of the lifestyle he'd been so attracted to.
As soon as Vile Bodies had been published, he abandoned this whole milieu altogether and went off travelling around the world, was received into the Roman Catholic Church, and effectively abandoned the social scene, of which he'd very sparingly been an ornament.
Like Waugh, Cecil Beaton moved on, selling his highly glamorous vision of the bright young lifestyle to an international audience. He established himself as one of the 20th century's most innovative photographers and designers.
People like Cecil Beaton were the sort of Malcolm McLaren of their day. You know, they were popularising it. They were making their careers out of this. You know, I mean, Cecil Beaton remained a bright young thing for the rest of his life. That's why he was still hanging out with the Rolling Stones at the age of 70 or whatever he was. So, you know, in a way, Beaton betrayed them, in a way. But people like Stephen Tennant and Brenda Dean Paul, who took it to the extreme, who either actually almost died for their art or just sort of still lived in that moment. Stephen was still living in that moment in 1986 when I met him at Willsford. Things hadn't changed. There were still letters from Virginia Woolf on the carpet, and, you know, as though they'd just arrived.
Where Stephen retreated from public life altogether, Elizabeth Ponsonby failed to notice that no one was watching.
Elizabeth kept on being a bright young person long after it was prudent for anybody to behave in that kind of way or to so openly admit that pleasure was what they sought and that they would pay almost any price to obtain it. And of course, the path led down and ever down. And so instead of going to the kind of parties that are written up in the Tatler and the Sketch, she's going to entertainments which are not written up anywhere. She's making friends yet more disreputable than the ones she made in the 1920s. And by the late 1930s, no longer a young woman, of course, she's eking out a career as a nightclub hostess and on remittances from her parents. And on the 31st of July 1940, just as the Battle of Britain and the Blitz were about to be unleashed upon Great Britain, her father gets this telegram from a doctor saying, "Regret to inform you, Elizabeth died suddenly this morning." Elizabeth Ponsonby, you know, that great mercurial figure, the great symbolic partygoer of the 1920s and early 30s, had died of drink before she was 40.
Elizabeth's passing was met with little fanfare. It's ironic that the bitter realities of her lifestyle and early death, like the bright young decade's miserable end, only underline how modern the era seems to us now and capture exactly what the 20s were. Decadent, doomed, but eternally irresistible. The very essence of glamour.